Good morning and happy Sunday. Welcome to Sacred Awakenings. I'm the Reverend Nicole Losey, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to this sacred space today. This is Sunday morning. It's our Sunday gathering. This is a time we come together in communion with each other and with the divine through music and message and meditation and intention. So thank you for taking the time to join us today, and welcome. I'm really glad you're here. Today's topic is presented by Reverend Gabriel. You may remember him. He presented music a couple of weeks ago. His topic is called Devotion, the Path to Wisdom. Rev Gabriel is taking us more actively from our discussion of the feminine into the discussion of the masculine. And we have Kim Buehler joining us again today. She will be presenting the music and taking us deeper into ourselves through song. So I hope that you can sit back and relax and create that space within yourself to receive the message and to allow it to settle into yourselves. Take a deep breath. And enjoy today's gathering.
Some say love, it is a river that drowns the tender reed. And some say love, it is a razor that leaves your soul to bleed. And some say love, it is a hunger.
Let us take a moment to connect with our breath and set our intention for this morning. Coming together, we create a collective divine heartbeat. We affirm truth and peace abide here. We gather to remember and recognize the divine mystery within. In our sacred circle, we honor the awakenings of each spirit who enters.
Aramaic Lord's Prayer. From an ancient text in Aramaic translated directly into English. O birther of the cosmos, focus your light within me, make it useful. Create your reign of unity now. Your one desire then sets as ours. As in all light, so in all forms. Grant us what we need each day in bread and insight. Loose the cords of mistakes binding us as we release the strands we hold of others' guilt. Do not allow surface things to delude us, but free us from what holds us back. From you is born all ruling will, the power and the life to do, the song that beautifies all. From age to age it renews. I affirm this with my whole being.
They may cause you tears. Go ahead, release your fears. Stand up and be counted. Don't be ashamed to cry. You gotta be bad. You gotta be bold. You gotta be wiser. You gotta be hard. You gotta be tough. You gotta be stronger. You gotta be cool. You gotta be calm. You gotta stay together. All I know is love will save the day. Herald what your mother said. Read the books your father read. Try to solve the problems in your own sweet time. Some may have more cash than you. Others take a different view. My, oh my, hey, hey. You gotta be bad, you gotta be bold, you gotta be wiser. You gotta be hard, you gotta be tough, you gotta be stronger. You gotta be cool, you gotta be calm, you gotta stay together. All I know is love will save the day. Time asks no questions, it goes on without you. Leaving you behind if you can't stand the pace. World keeps on spinning, can't stop it if you try to. Danger is staring you in the face. Oh, listen as your day unfolds. Challenge what the future holds. Try and keep your head up to the sky. Lovers, they may cause you tears. Go ahead, release your fears. My, oh my, hey, hey. You gotta be bad, you gotta be bold, you gotta be wiser. You gotta be hard, you gotta be tough, you gotta be stronger. You gotta be cool, you gotta be calm, you gotta stay together. All I know is love will save the day.
Thank you, Kim, for that wonderful music. We often hear all the you gotta be's and the shoulds all around us. And that song reminds us that we really need to cut through all that and tap into our deeper wisdom, our own wisdom. And today's talk is about that, is about how we get to that wisdom through some examples and some stories. But first, a little introduction. My name is Reverend Gabriel. That's my spirit name that was given to me when I went through seminary as an interspiritual minister. My given name is Rich Lindner. You've probably seen me in some of the gatherings. So, and I'm very honored to be the guest speaker in the spirit of sacred awakenings and vulnerability. I will say that this is not something I typically do, so I ask for your patience as I talk today and understanding, and I know I'll find that in this community. If you hear a little whiny noise in the background, that's because I have a little dog running around who's really upset that I'm not allowing her to go and feast on the cicadas, which she just loves the cicadas. Okay, so let's talk about discipline, or another word for discipline, devotion, as the path to wisdom. That's the topic for today. What is discipline, devotion, and practice, and how do they lead? How are they the path to deep wisdom? Well, let's examine that a little bit. First, I want to give a little illustration. Let's imagine that we have two individual dancers, and they're both really practiced at their path, but they haven't met each other, and they've just been given the task to work together to create a dance piece. So, when they're separate, they're two dancers. Let's just in this example, say they're male and female, because we're talking, as Deb brought up last week, around the yin and yang and the sacred duality of masculine, feminine. So these two dancers, each very, very proficient in dancing on their own, now have to learn a new dance that doesn't exist yet. It hasn't been performed by them in their own unique way. So first they meet each other and agree to work together. And that takes compassion. Again, what we've talked about in the previous weeks. And they start to learn the moves. They start dancing, but it's at first it might be out of sync, and then over time things get more and more in sync. The dance gets better and better. But they're still kind of thinking about their movements. They're still learning. And then at some point, there's something magical happens. And this happens often in art and drama, things like that, where it just clicks, where there's flow. They no longer have to learn, or they no longer have to think about what they're doing. The dance becomes an entity of itself. It becomes the whole. And their movements are so in sync, they don't think about it. And let's say you're sitting in the audience and watching this dance, at some point you're watching very mindfully, you're very much, and you just feel the intensity, you feel the wholeness of the dance, and it becomes all about the dance. You're experiencing the dance, this new art form, this new entity that has been brought into existence. And you're not thinking about the individual dancers. The dance itself becomes the whole. And that represents that divine whole, the unity aspect, the circle that's around the yin-yang diagram. And so the understanding of how to do the dance without thinking about just the natural flow of what happens to the dance, that represents deep wisdom. It's not something that the dancers think about or the audience that's part of the whole that's taking in the beautiful artistic expression. It's there. It's beyond thought-based definition. Yet, if you really think about it, if you break it down, there are two distinct answers. There is a duality that exists there. But in the highest expression and highest experiencing, whether you're the dancer or you're observing, is the unity of the dance. You know, the dancers disappear. There's a sutra. A sutra is a sacred saying or writing called the Heart Sutra that's at the center of many branches of Buddhism, including Zen, my home tradition. The Heart Sutra has a line in it that says, form is emptiness, emptiness is form. And it says that things are empty, in of themselves. And they speak of this deep wisdom. They call it Prajnaparamita, which is the heart of all understanding. This deep understanding that isn't understanding, isn't a conceptual understanding. It's a deep understanding. Feeling something or feeling understanding gets closer to it, but it's even bigger than that. It's just this inner knowing, this inner beingness. So the dancers are just completely absorbed in the dance. They're part of the dance. They're no longer the individuals, you know. And so that when we're in this place of unity consciousness, really tapped in to our essence, our beingness, then the wisdom is just there. It's just something that is spontaneous. There's no effort. It just flows from us. It flows from our being. But let's back up a little bit. When those two dancers first met, they weren't able to do that dance. They had to work at it. They had to set a schedule. They had to find compatibility. They had to build a relationship so they could work together. So discipline or devotion or practice, I really personally like the word practice, but that's my own preference, is the structures and the effort and what brought them to that point. So in spirituality, we often come across paradoxes, things that seem contradictory when looked at analytically or looked at from a material world basis. They seem like, okay, how can something be a duality and a whole at the same time? This example illustrates that. At the highest level of expression and experiencing this dance, it's the dance. It's an entity in itself. It is the whole. And yet there's two individual dancers, and then there's the audience too, the observer of it, that's experience, that makes the experience. What is art if there's no one there to experience it? So this deep wisdom, the deep reality of the dance, of the art, of the whole. So when the Heart Sutra says that things are empty, when you're considering the dance, if you all of a sudden zero in, let's say you zero in on the male dancer. Well, the male dancer is empty in terms of he's just part of the dance. And if you really zero in on that and you tune out the female dancer, you tune out the whole, it's really empty of its deepest essence or meaning. Okay, so in our example, we saw that the two dancers represented two aspects of a duality that come together in a whole. Well, the theme at Sacred Awakenings for the last couple months through May and June is another duality, and that's the duality of the divine feminine and masculine. In May, we talked about the divine feminine. And that's the yin side of the yin-yang, that's associated with rest, kind of a quietness, wet versus dry, passive versus active, the yang, which is the more masculine of the two. And I think it's easy to see that we all have aspects of both. And Deb stated it beautifully that you can think of bringing those natures. Those natures can either be in conflict or we can deny parts of it. Say we're culturally, like say as a man, I'm culturally conditioned to deny my feminine nature. So it sets up a shadow and all kinds of, you know, separation within my mind, as opposed to this progression of first finding balance between the two. And then that evolves into harmony, you know, the higher being, where it just effortlessly exists, our masculine and feminine natures live together in harmony in one divine dance. And I love that. I love that progression. Just like the dancers had to go from not even knowing each other and not knowing the dance to learning the dance to being proficient at it and then getting the state of flow and really becoming the dance. It's this progression from separation to balance to harmony. Okay, so let's dig a little deeper into this idea of discipline or devotion or practices, and let's look at some examples of how that applies practically. Because we all, if you're in this community, you're committed to having a spiritual practice, living a spiritual life. So from a practical standpoint, what does this mean? For me, I can only speak from my experience. And in my experience, at the center of my practice is being present, being fully present in that deep wisdom, heart wisdom, whatever you want to call it, prajnaparamita, whatever. And I operate on this principle where it's almost like a little flow chart, if you think of it, where every moment of every day, I try to be aware of one thing. Am I centered in my soul? Am I centered in my spirit, my heart, whatever, heart center, Buddha nature, Christ consciousness, whatever words work for you? Am I centered in that at any given moment? And if not, I have one job, and that's to get centered. Because once I'm centered, when I'm centered in this divine wisdom, the sense of wisdom, I'll know what to do. If I'm not, if I'm out of center, I'm like, you know, my inner dancers are wandering around aimlessly and apart, then whatever I do is going to cause suffering, and it's going to come from delusion. I won't have that sense of peace, that objective sense of peace of being in wisdom. So what I do is I develop certain practices, and these could be rituals, vows, and I'm going to get into a couple examples that helps me with that process of, one, being awake enough to know when I'm not awake, which, again, sounds paradoxical, but to apply that principle. Am I awake? 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 So if I'm not present, then that's where the practice comes in. And there could be so many different reasons that have brought me out of balance, out of presence. And they're as unique as, you know, people are unique, even more so. You know, it could be a triggering event. It could be a past memory. It could be processing trauma, whatever it is. And then through our practice, through our vows and rituals, it's bringing, you apply to that specifically, having the wisdom and understanding of what to apply in that particular situation. So let's get into some real specific examples. A key practice in my own life is mindfulness. A great teacher for me personally is the Zen monk and prolific author Thich Nhat Hanh, a Vietnamese author. And years ago, when I was, you know, looking for ways to improve my presence, my ability to be present, I read a book of his called The Art of Mindful Living. And in it, he had the concept that he put forward that was very powerful was, it's all well and good to meditate, to sit in meditation in the morning. But he mentioned turning your whole life into a meditation, and he gave an example that was I thought really humorous, and I heard him talk of this when I went on a retreat at his monastery in Mississippi in 2013, where he had mentioned he was talking about his friendship with the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. They had started a correspondence in the 60s and became friends. And Thich Nhat Hanh came to visit Martin Luther King at his church in Atlanta. Thich Nhat Hanh had said in his culture, the Vietnamese culture, it's very reserved. You know, hugging isn't a thing. Well, at Martin Luther King's church in Atlanta, hugging was definitely a thing. It was a big aspect of connection, how that just wonderful community would connect with each other. So he said, you know, when he first arrived there, people would hug him. And he said, you know, he was very stiff. He said, I was a bad hugger. And then he said, so I practiced hugging meditation. And now I am a good hugger. So mindfulness to him is bringing the focus, that focus on the present moment into whatever you're doing and turning into a meditation. In my own life, I did this with the laundry. The laundry was kind of a chore, a tedious chore, and I'd probably put on music in the background or a podcast, or I don't know if podcasts existed back then, but to distract myself. And I would, you know, just get this chore out of the way. Well, I turned laundry into a mindfulness practice where I really focus. I have no music or anything on. I would really focus on folding the laundry. And it's become one of the most enjoyable things that I do. There's also meditation, which has become a verb to meditate in popular usage. If you look at yoga and some of the traditions, Buddhist tradition, really meditation is a state of mind, and the practice is concentration, but that's okay. So I'll speak of it as it's popularly become. So meditation. An example of a ritual. And rituals can be just something that's very regular that brings you into the sacred. It doesn't have to be in a church. It doesn't have to involve candles and incense, though it can. When I was learning to meditate, which was one of the most difficult things that I had to do, which is ironic, learning how to sit and do nothing was one of the hardest things I've ever done. A wonderful meditation teacher who kind of broke through and taught me, talked about the ritualization of, in particular, the morning meditation. And she used a three-letter acronym, RPM, for this ritual, this morning ritual. And that's rise, pee, and meditate. So you see, rituals don't have to be solemn. They can be kind of funny. So, but the point was that it was something you just do. It's something you do regularly. And she stressed the importance that it's not something you time or schedule. It's something that just happens naturally, and it becomes, and brushing your teeth in the morning is kind of like that. It just becomes something that naturally becomes ingrained, gets ritualized within your daily practice. Okay, let's discuss another aspect of devotion, and that are vows. You know, vows are something that typically don't come along very often in your life, but they can be very powerful. The example I'd like to talk about in my own life is my ministerial vows. In 2017, I was ordained along with our very own Reverend Nicole Losey as an ordained interspiritual minister through One Spirit Learning Alliance out of New York City. Wonderful, wonderful experience. At the end of the seminary experience, we had a retreat on the Hudson River in this just beautiful retreat center. And we had a ceremony where we were to recite our ministerial vow. So each of us had to come up with a ministerial vow, and I dutifully did mine. Probably was kind of wordy. I put a lot of work into it. And then on the day of the ceremony, I woke up with a strong sense to throw it out, throw that vow out. That's not it. Here's your vow. And my vow was one sentence, very simple. I, Reverend Gabriel, vow to courageously live from spirit. That's it. And that evening, in this beautiful ceremony, when I recited it in front of my 70 or so other classmates, I felt this power. The power that came from within, from the eternal, that came from this place of deep, deep wisdom. And the power of the vow is in its simplicity, and also to me, as somebody who tends to be very much in my head and very analytical, and that what this was telling me, okay, it's time to tune in to your intuitive side. And you're going to have moments where you fall into old patterns, or over-analyzing things, you know, whatever it is. You need to come home, come to spirit, and learn the art of discernment, of discerning deeply from this place of wisdom. So that's an example of a vow. So it's a commitment you make to your deeper self, to come home to that deeper self, in this case, to come home to that deeper self. And maybe a vow in relationship to another person, a marriage vow. It could be a vow to an organization. You know, it's a reminder. It's that reminder to come back, attention here and now, come back to the present moment, come back to your heart center. To summarize, we've talked today about devotion or discipline as the path to wisdom. Wisdom being that deep knowing beyond all mind knowing. And that devotion is the means or the way we get to that place. We uncover the essence, our essence. I'd like to thank you very much for allowing me to speak to you today. And I would like to close with a guided meditation that is designed to help us with that practice of remembering in the moment to come back and come back home to our center. So please just settle in to a comfortable posture where you can be comfortably alert. You know, sitting is fine with a, you know, straight back or whatever's comfortable, whatever your body is saying, this is what I want to do. Just allow it to settle into that posture. And please close your eyes, because this meditation involves visualization. So please close your eyes and begin just to breathe naturally. Don't try to control your breaths. Just allow the breaths. And gently observe your breath. Breathing in, I know I'm breathing in. Breathing out, I know I'm breathing out. allow any thoughts or sensations that come up just to be. And then bring your attention back to your breath, your in-breath and your out-breath. These sensations and thoughts will naturally subside. And now call to mind something that your heart is telling you needs attention. Something that tends to come up in daily life where you would like to choose a different path when it comes up. It may be that moment at work when you're walking by a box of donuts and for once you want to walk by it and not open the box. It may be somebody in your life who tends to trigger you or tends to say things or do things that take you into that state of separation. And just allow it to come naturally. If nothing's coming up, that's okay. If nothing specific comes up, just think of a very generic situation and we're about to visualize. Okay, now call to mind the situation in your mind's eye as if you're a movie director and you're in your mind, you're constructing the set, the sounds, the sights, the actors, the people. And just allow it to fill in. And now place yourself in that place. If it's safe, if it's brings up feelings that are too intense to deal with right now, then please, please pull back and just continue to observe your breath. Otherwise, put yourself in this place and imagine going through the scenario. You're approaching the person or the box of donuts or whatever it is, but you're in a place of serenity. You're in this place, you're observing your own mind, and you allow the reaction to occur, the internal sensation, whatever comes up when you see the person or you encounter the situation. And hit the pause button. And in that moment, just choose to observe that sensation, to step back like you were doing with your breath. And just feel yourself naturally settle into the deep place of wisdom. Just feel this centering. And just allow it to happen at its own pace. With each breath, and there will come a point where you see things differently, where you might have gone down automatically one path before. Now you see a different path. Maybe it's to feel compassion or feel loving kindness for the person you're encountering. Maybe it's just to allow time for the impulse or the craving or whatever it is, just to naturally subside. And once that intention takes hold, to take that different path, just follow that path, walk right by the donuts, smile at the person, whatever it is. Just allow yourself to really feel in the situation. Or if it's not a situation, just bring your attention back to your breath without controlling. And if you'd like, hit the replay button to replay the scenario. So you start to learn and practice the art of centering in your deep wisdom. We'll allow a couple minutes of silence for you to do that as many times as you like. And now we're gently going to come back to our space together. In my workshops and support groups that do this, sometimes something really powerful comes up, and sometimes it doesn't. If something did powerful come up, I suggest that after the service today, you go somewhere and write down whatever the intention was, whatever, you know, whether it was a person, whatever situation, to actually write it somewhere, maybe on an index card. That's what we do in the groups. That will reinforce the intention. And of course, feel free to practice this on your own. It is a really powerful practice. Okay, thank you again so much for allowing me to speak to this blessed sacred community, Sacred Awakenings. And I wish all of you well.
Come and find the quiet center in the crowded life we lead. Find the room for hope to enter. Find the frame where we are freed. Clear the chaos and the clutter. Clear our eyes that we may see all the things that really matter. Be at peace and simply be.
In considering our message, our music, our meditation, and all that Sacred Awakenings offers the community that gathers, we ask that you consider a love offering or energy exchange at our website, sacredawakenings.org. Please join me in this blessing. Divine love, through me, blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Divine love, through us, blesses and multiplies all that we have, all that we give, and all that we receive. May your generosity you share with Sacred Awakenings continue to bless you with divine abundance and prosperity. Thank you.
Earth, teach me. A Native American prayer. Earth, teach me quiet, as the grasses are still with new light. Earth, teach me suffering, as old stones suffer with memory. Earth, teach me humility, as blossoms are humble with beginning. Earth, teach me caring, as mothers nurture their young. Earth, teach me courage, as the tree that stands alone. Earth, teach me limitation, as the ant that crawls on the ground. Earth, teach me freedom, as the eagle that soars in the sky. Earth, teach me acceptance, as the leaves that die each fall. Earth, teach me renewal, as the seed that rises in the spring. Earth, teach me to forget myself, as melted snow forgets its life. Earth, teach me to remember kindness, as dry fields weep with rain. Aho.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Reverend Gabriel. And thank you, Kim, for sharing your wonderful messages through your talk and through your music. There are so many ways to connect with each other and to connect with the divine. And I just want to say thank you so much for sharing your gifts with us and allowing us to discover and find our own gifts through your messages. I invite you, everyone, to stick around after our gathering today for a discussion. This is a time when we go deeper into the message. We share and we learn from each other how the messages sit within us as individuals. And we have an opportunity to explore the messages at a deeper level. So I invite you to stick around for that when we're all finished. And remember that you can always catch us again later by listening to the podcast on YouTube or Facebook or anywhere you can get your podcasts. You can check in with us again later. Thank you so much for joining us today. We are truly a co-created community, and thank you for being part of our Sunday morning gathering. May you experience Sacred Awakenings each and every day.
God, there's peace on earth, I know it be. This is the moment now. With every step I take, this is my joyous vow. I take each moment and live each moment in peace.
Thanks for joining us today. Hope you can stick around. If you plan on sticking around for the chat, get up, stretch, move around, do what you need to do, take a little break. Come back in about 5 minutes, and Georgia will lead us in a moment of stillness so that we can connect with the topic and transition back after our break. See you soon.